Good morning. All right, we're live on both devices. Perfect. So this is about how to pray, part three. So we're breaking this down into seven parts. We have praise, confession, there's thanking, petition others, thanks again, intercession, and praise. So today what we're going to do, we're going to talk about forgiveness and repentance connected to this. And this is going to be a two-edged sword of what we're doing. We're doing two and three today. So it's thanking and confessing combination of what we did yesterday, praise and thanks for one and two, for one and three. So we already covered those. So we're going to do confession and forgiveness today. Parts two and six, intercession and confession, can sometimes be intercombined though, and you'll learn about that here in a bit. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just ask you that you just come to us now as we learn more about what it means to pray, what it means to pray for others, what it means to pray for ourselves, what it means to pray for leaders, and what does your word say about it today? In your name we pray, amen. Let us pray, let us pray, everywhere and every way, every moment of the day. It is the right time for the Father above. He is listening with love. Oh, let us pray without end, and when we finish, start again, like breathe it out and breathe it in. Oh, let us pray. That song is perfect for every day. And I mean, I wasn't thinking about this last night. And Miranda said, why don't you try this today? And I said, okay. And my thing I got stuck on trying to do it, was I didn't know where to put my capo for this one. And I decided to use my old one instead of the new one in case I ran into problems like I did yesterday. So I thought, well, let's just go through the choruses and just combine the two. And that would just be straight and direct where... what God wants to do today. And I honestly believe that the more we learn about what prayer is, and the more we learn about what God wants, the more we can move the mountains and valleys called our life, the more we can see people's lives restored, the more that we can understand our communication with God.
Everything that has breath is the Lord. Everything that has breath is the Lord. I praise you in the morning, I praise you in the evening, I praise you when I'm young and when I'm old. I praise you when I'm laughing, I praise you when I'm breathing, I praise you in the season of the soul. We could see how much you're worth, your power, your might, your endless love, then surely we would never cease to praise. Everything that has been praised, the Lord. Everything that has been praised, the Lord. Praise you in the heavens, join with the angels, and praise you forever and a day. And praise you on the earth now, join with creation, and call your nations to your praise. We could see how much you work, your power, your might, your endless love, and surely we would never cease to praise. Everything that has been praised, the Lord. Everything that has been praised, the Lord.
Can we say that today, that with everything there is about us, The mountains and valleys called our lives. The things that have happened in spite of the circumstances of who and where we've been and what may have been and may have not have been. Can we do this today? Can we reach out to God today and say, God, I just want to talk to you today. I want to have a conversation with you today. Proverbs 1:5 says, a wise man or woman will hear an increase in learning and acquire of understanding will acquire wise counsel. So there's a lesson that is learned that there's no substitute for paying attention. And when we pray to God, we have to pay attention because he answers us all day long. And sometimes years later. There was a band of thieves that were well-refined method of operation. They entered a store as a group. They would separate. And they would start a loud argument, cause problems, which caused the clerks and those working in the store to be distracted so someone could grab the item, put it in their pockets, and leave. And no one ever got caught. Later, people realized stuff was missing. And by that time, they're gone. There's no trace. They don't know who did it. It's like several days later. Temptation works the same way. Distractions, the lure of fame, fortune, power, satisfaction, fleshly desires, all these things that happen in our life. And it takes us off of what God wants to do in our life. And without having prayer, we're not able to do that. Today is about forgiveness, petitions, repentance. It's about what do I need to change in my life? What do we need to do with our lives? Where are we headed? Do we even really understand? As Benjamin Franklin says, there's great beauty and great strength and great riches are really and truly of no great use. A right heart exceeds all. So it's not going to matter if you put yourself into this plan that you're going to get all this money, you're going to get all this promotion, you're going to get all this stuff, yet you are deteriorating inside and you are falling apart and you wonder why God isn't hearing you and you wonder why things aren't changing. You might be successful in the world, but your spiritual life is rotten to the core. Many times, many people have to choose God or success. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. And in all your ways, acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. Are we trying to let God make our path straight today? Or do we want to sit here and just continually fall to the wayside and not move into the place that God wants us to be? Romans 8, 17, 18 says, if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer for him, that we may also be glorified together, for I consider that the sufferings of the present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Hello, Archie. Good morning. So we're going to pull this open. Repentance, forgiveness. Examples of repentance and forgiveness would be of you admitting that you have fault. So those of you that are involved in recovery, one of the things you have to do in recovery is take a personal inventory of your life. And if it's a situation that's safe, try to correct the wrongs that were done. If it's not a safe situation, at least write a letter or something to those situations. But if there's something you've done, you've got to own up to what has happened in your life. And when you see these shackles fall off you, because what happens many times when we have unforgiveness in our heart, or we have anger in our heart, or we have something in our life that is causing us to stumble, it's not affecting the other person that was normally involved. It's affecting us. Well, this person hurt me. Well, this person did this to me. Well, this person did that. Proverbs 17:9 says, whoever conceals an offense promotes love, but whoever gossips about it separates friends. See, that's the one thing society has today, is we have no problem pulling out our cell phones today when someone has fallen on the ice. It's funny. Well, let's take it to the next step. There's TV shows that show people just being downright rude and hateful. And they get millions of views on other sites because it's what they do. There's a culture out there today that wants to see people fail and enjoy it. And people are almost to the point that they're taking lots. They're taking bets and gambling over who's going to fall the most, who's going to make the biggest joke of themselves. What have we done in society when we don't understand what it means to forgive our brother or sister what they've done? When we don't understand what it means to move into purity of what God wants to do? Ephesians chapter 4, starting at verse 20. It says, "But that is not how you came to know Christ, assuming you heard about him and you were taught by him, as the truth is Jesus, to take off your former way of life, the old self that is corrupted by deceitful desires, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds." Hey, Santosh, how's it going? "And to put on the new self, one created accordingly to God's likeness, in righteousness and purity of truth." 25. "Therefore, put away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down in your anger. Do not give the devil an opportunity. Let the thief no longer steal. Instead, he is to do honest work with his own hands, so that he has something to share with anyone in need. No foul language should come out from your mouth, but only what is good for building up someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear. And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You are sealed by him for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, anger, wrath, shouting and slander be removed from you among all, with all malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another just as God also forgave you in Christ." That's a lot to swallow. But see, here's the thing. The one thing that happens as you get older in your walk with Christ, I know there are several people that they don't struggle with cussing. I mean, you could drop a hammer on their foot and they'll say, "Oh, pickles, pig's feet," or oh, gee, Willy Wonkers," or something. They'll just make something up, and they won't cuss. But if you communicate with them, they'll have a horrible tone in their voice, and you tell them, "I don't understand that." "Well, you should already understand what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about." And they talk like that, and their communication is seasoned in such a way that it doesn't give glory to God, and it could just be the tone of the voice. For those of us that have been stuck in a house a lot, your tone of voice is probably changed the longer you've been around somebody. What does that say about us as a people and as a culture that we can't be in a house with someone for 40 days? We need our own space. We need to be able to do our own thing. "Oh, I got to go take a ride. I got to go take a walk. I can't deal with you anymore." What have we done? Matthew 6:14 says, "If you forgive others their offenses, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive others, your Father will not forgive your offenses." These are some big words to swallow today. And it's tough because a lot of times the pain and the suffering that we believe that we are going through or have gone through is worth holding on to the pains and sufferings of the current situation of staying angry and staying frustrated. And I'm not talking to this family member. I'm not going to go see this person. I'm not going to do this person because this person has done me wrong. I'm not going to call them back. I'm not going to write them back. I think every one of us have been in this situation before. We write and call somebody and they don't write back. And in some cases, you just have to accept the situation and move on and don't hold on to the things that are of this world. If you go to Colossians, we're going to start in chapter 3. And in verse 5, it talks about, again, put to death what belongs to your earthly nature. But I'm also going to go further than that. We're going to start there at 5. And it says sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desire, greed, which is idolatry, because these, God's wrath is coming upon the disobedient. And you once walked in these things when you were living in them, but now put away all the following: anger, wrath, malice, slander, filthy language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old self with its practices and put on the new self. You are being renewed in the knowledge according to the image of your Creator. Then we go to 12. Therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly beloved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone is a grievance against you, just as the Lord forgiven you, so you are to also forgive. Above all, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. And let the peace of Christ to you, to which you were also called in one body, rule your hearts, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell richly among you, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another through psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. See, that's another thing. Question to you. How many sing at church? How many sing outside of church? And I guarantee someone didn't raise their hand. We're living in a society today where we have a Sunday morning experience, and many churches are not open beyond a Sunday morning. They don't have the workers. They don't have the money to keep the building open. But then you go further and take it the next step. Well, why don't people do this at home? Because a lot of places haven't talked about it. Some places don't have a new Christian training course so people can learn what it means. Some people will get saved, they'll get baptized, and that's about it. And they go back to the same things that they've always experienced. Because too many people say, well, that's too religious. That's too structured. That's too old way.
They get just enough religion to make them miserable.
Yeah, I mean, they've had a bad experience in the past with something else. And all these things happen and cause people to fall away. I was talking to somebody last night, and I'm not going to go on the whole thing, but the one thing that stood out for the conversation that was over an hour, me and about 20 people, as we were talking about what I just said about the church and people in the church not communicating with one another beyond the internet. And the conversation was about, it's great that we have this social media experience, but if people get lazy and all they want to do is sit and watch a preacher just talking on the computer, you won't have anyone come be a greeter. You won't have anyone come do the music. You won't have anyone come and do the regular things that a church needs, and the structure and the places that's supposed to be. And that's what we have to be careful of today, church, is that we don't fall short of what God wants to do. Because when we let that happen, the devil takes his seat in our lives, and he concretes into our church, and he starts changing things. If we look at 2 Chronicles 7:14, and I'll bring it up to 14, it says, I've heard your prayer, this is in the middle of 12, and I've chosen this place for myself as a temple of sacrifice. If I shut the sky so there's no rain, or I command the grasshopper to consume the land, or if I send pestilence on my people, and my people who bear my name humble themselves, pray and seek my face, turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. My eyes will now be open, and my ears attentive to prayer from this place. And I have now chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name be there forever. My eyes and heart will be there at all times. Are we doing that today? Are we communicating with God in such a way that He'll listen to our petitions because we've removed the stones that are in our life and removed those stones out of the way, removed that sin out of the way so that we can start talking about what God's going to do for our life? And here's the thing. When your prayer life continues to grow. And like I said before, pray without ceasing. That means your whole day should be a form of worship to God. So that means everything you do, from you making food, to you using the bathroom, to you driving the car, to you writing your name on a piece of paper, to you going to buy the groceries, to you having an argument with your spouse, everything that you're doing is supposed to be a form of worship. Now, if you put that mindset in your head, it's going to change your dialogue. It's going to change how you talk. It's going to change what you do and where you go and who you talk to and how much you talk. Nehemiah 9:31. However, in your abundant compassion, you did not destroy them or abandon them, for you are a gracious and compassionate God. Verse 30. You were patient with them for many years, and your spirit warned them through your prophets, but they would not listen. Therefore, you handed them over to the surrounding peoples. However, in your abundant compassion, you did not destroy them or abandon them, for you are a gracious and compassionate God. See, God could lay down his vengeance. God could say, no, you've had enough chances. You've gone through enough. You've seen enough. You know, no more. I'm not going to listen to you anymore. You know, like you're in trouble in school or trouble with your spouse or something else. What's one of the things a lot of people will say? I'm done talking to you. I have nothing else to say. Or they just sit there and don't say anything. God isn't going to shut the door on you. Until the day of your death, God is going to continue to try and reach you until it's the actual end of times and Revelation. Until you actually get to that point, God is going to keep knocking on your heart and say, my child, come to me and I'll help you. And that's the other thing. People think you got to come to God after you got everything fixed. This isn't psychology or sociology. This is a relationship with Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. This isn't your therapist. There's a big difference. So if you go to Micah chapter 7, verse 18, it says, who is a God like you, forgiving iniquity and passing over rebellion? For the remnant of his inheritance, he does not hold on to his anger forever, because he delights in faithful love. He will again have compassion on us. He will vanquish our iniquities. He will cast out all our sins into the depths of the sea. Isn't it great to know that God will restore your life? Now, of course, restoring your life may mean some people that were in your life may no longer be in your life. It may mean you may change locations. You may change jobs. But you will feel different. You will see something different in your life. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2. He himself is the atoning sacrifice of our sins, not only for ours, but for those of the whole world. This is how we know that we know him, if we keep his commands. The one who says, I have come to know him, and yet doesn't keep his commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly in him, the love of God is made complete. This is how we know we are in him. The one who says he remains in him should walk just as he walked. So today, forgiveness and repentance. Examine your hearts today of what might be going on that's causing all your anger, causing all your frustration. And is there someone you need to apologize to? Is there someone that you need to do a service to? Is there somebody that you need to, in your mind, they don't even know you've done anything. Maybe it's in your mind that we're talking about. You didn't verbally say anything. You didn't physically withhold something. You didn't do anything extreme. Is there something that you need to change? Do you need to ask God that you want to repent of not spending enough time in prayer? Is there something other level in your life that God wants to transform your life? Is there something that's that you're holding on to today that's just caused you frustration? We've all been frustrated by something, some way, somehow. We've all been let down. We've all had people do harm to us. I've been physically assaulted. I've had people shoot at me. I've had someone try to set me on fire. I've had things stolen from me. I've had people talk ill about me. I've seen those kinds of things. I know what that's like. But are you willing today to just let God come and wrap His arms around you? That's what we ask. Is that God just comes and brings you to a place of peace in your life? And it won't come without understanding what it means to forgive. What it means to let God help you. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrow and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life was born. Jesus is calling. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before Him. For He's Lord of all, of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross for your weight as a crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found. Heavenly Father, we come before You today just asking that You help us understand how to forgive. Help us understand what it means to repent and let go of these things that are in our lives that are holding us back. Are we frustrated with somebody? Are we frustrated with ourselves? Have we committed offense to somebody? Have we caused people to fall away from themselves? God, we need Your help today. And lead us to that place You want us to be. Amen. Drifting beneath the horizon. Body is weak, but I'm trying to make it to shore. I'm falling short. I need You more. Wave after wave I've been sinking. So unto your promise I'm clinging. You say that I'm strong. To you I belong. Keep holding on. You are my anchor. So steady me now. You are my anchor. You're keeping my feet on the ground. In angry oceans you never broke it. Through every wave of the storm. You are my anchor. So steady me now. Come steady me now. When I get tired of the fighting, all of the fears I've been hiding, gave me a breath, tell me to rest, you never left. I can hear you calling me by my name, pulling me out from under my shame. Never gonna be the same. I can face anything, but let it rain. You are my anchor. So steady me now. You are my anchor. You're keeping my feet on the ground. In angry oceans, you're never broken. Through every wave of the storm, you are my anchor. So steady me now. Come steady me now. Alone. And don't let go. I know that I'll drown on my own. You are my anchor. So steady me now. You are my anchor. You're keeping my feet on the ground. In angry oceans, you never broke it. Through every wave of the storm, you are my anchor. So steady me now. Come steady me now. Let God be the anchor for you today as you continue to learn how to pray. Today was confession, repentance. Tomorrow we're going to talk about petition and talking about what others need. And how do we talk to God about what others need? And in some cases, you'll learn that you are the person that God is sending for that person's storm. God bless you. We'll see you very soon.